welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
On today's program, Katie Weaver has a report on the drop in violent crime in the United States last year. Mario Ritter Jr. and Jill Robbins have this week's education report. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first, here is Katie Weaver.
Violent crime decreased in the United States in 2023. A new report from the Federal Bureau of Investigation says. The FBI released its report Monday. The report shows violent crime dropped an estimated 3% in 2023 from the year before. Murders dropped almost 12%. Here is what the Associated Press said about the FBI report. Crime increased sharply during the coronavirus pandemic, with homicides increasing by nearly 30% in 2020 from the year before. That was the largest one-year increase since the FBI began keeping records. Experts said possible reasons for the rise include the huge disruption of the pandemic, gun violence, worries about the economy, and intense stress. The FBI data show that in 2022, violent crime across the U.S. decreased to levels near those before the pandemic. Crime continued to decrease last year from 377 violent crimes per 100,000 people in 2022 to 364 per 100,000 people in 2023. Deputy Assistant Director Brian Griffith of the FBI's Criminal Justice Information Services Division said that rate is a little higher than the 2019 rate. Are we looking at crime rates at a return to pre-pandemic levels? I think a reasonable person would look at that and say, yes, that's what has happened, Griffith told the AP. The largest cities, those with populations of 1 million or more, recorded the biggest drop in violent crime at almost 7%. Agencies in communities of 250,000 to almost 500,000 people reported an increase of 0.3% between 2022 and 2023. Rape decreased more than 9%, while aggravated assault decreased nearly 3%. Overall, property crime decreased 2%, but automobile stealing increased 13%. There were about 319 motor vehicle thefts per 100,000 people in 2023. That was the largest increase since 2007. The FBI collects data through its Uniform Crime Reporting Program. Not all law enforcement agencies in the U.S. take part in the reporting. The 2023 report is based on data from more than 16,000 agencies, or more than 85% of those agencies in the FBI's program. The agencies included in the report protect almost 316 million people across America. And every agency with at least 1 million people in its jurisdiction provided a full year of data to the FBI, the report said. What you're not seeing in that number are a lot of very small agencies, Griffith said. I'm Katie Weaver.
Christina Westman hoped to become a music therapist when she came to St. Cloud State University in Minnesota. But that became impossible when the college announced a plan to cut its music department, along with 42 other study programs. The move is part of a wave of program cuts among small and large colleges in the United States. The aim of the cuts is to deal with budget deficits. Causes for the deficits include less government money, rising operational costs, and fewer students. The cuts mean more than reduced budget deficits or job losses. For me, it's really been anxiety-ridden, said Westman. It's just the fear of the unknown. At St. Cloud State, most students will be able to finish their degrees before the cuts. But Westman is transferring to Augsburg University in Minneapolis.
For years, many colleges avoided making cuts, said Larry Lee. He was acting president of St. Cloud State, but left last month to lead Blackburn College in Illinois. The number of students enrolling in college dropped during the pandemic, but officials hoped the number would return to levels that existed before the COVID pandemic. They had used federal aid money to ease budget deficits. They were holding on, Lee said. The National Student Clearinghouse Research Center said students have begun to return to two-year community colleges, but the numbers for four-year colleges remain lower than expected. Even without growing concerns about the high cost of college and student debt, the population of young adults in the U.S. is shrinking. Birth rates fell during the Great Recession of 2007 to 2009 and never recovered. Now, smaller classes of high school students are preparing to finish and head off to college. It's very difficult math to overcome, said Patrick Lane, a vice president at the Western Interstate Commission for Higher Education. In addition, the new federal government's financial aid application has created more confusion. Millions of students are wondering where to go to college and how to pay for it. Catherine Meyer is an expert with the Brown Center on Education Policy at the Brookings Institution. She said, "I think a lot of colleges are really concerned they're not going to make their enrollment targets." Many colleges, like St. Cloud State, had already faced budget problems. The university's enrollment rose to around 18,300 students in the autumn of 2020, before steadily falling to about 10,000 students in 2023. Its student population has stopped shrinking, but the budget deficit totaled $32 million over the past 2 years, forcing the sweeping cuts, Lee said.
Some colleges have taken the more extreme step of closing. That happened at the 1,000-student Birmingham Southern College in Alabama, the 900-student Fontbonne University in Missouri, the 350-student Wells College in New York, and the 220-student Goddard College in Vermont. Cuts, however, are more common. Two of North Carolina's public universities, in Asheville and Greensboro, plan to cut 14 programs, including Ancient Mediterranean Studies and Physics. Arkansas State University announced it was ending 9 programs. 3 of the 64 colleges in the State University of New York system have also cut programs because of low enrollment and budget problems. Other schools cutting study programs include West Virginia University, Drake University in Iowa, the University of Nebraska campus in Kearney, North Dakota State University, and nearby Dickinson State University. Experts say it is just the beginning. Schools that are not making cuts now are examining their class offerings. At Pennsylvania State University, officials are looking for similar or under-enrolled programs to cut.
The most affected programs are usually smaller ones and those in the humanities, which now have fewer students than 15 years ago. It's a humanitarian disaster for all of the faculty and staff involved, not to mention the students who want to pursue this stuff, said Brian Alexander, a Georgetown University senior scholar who has written on higher education. It's an open question to what extent colleges and universities can cut their way to sustainability. Terry Vermillion recently retired after 34 years as a music professor at St. Cloud State. He said, "The cuts are hard to watch after the pandemic. We were just unable to really effectively teach music online. So there's a gap," he said. "And you know, we're just starting to come out of that gap, and we're just starting to rebound a little bit, and then the cuts are coming." Lily Rhodes is a music major at St. Cloud State. Rhodes said, "There's no musicians coming in, so when our seniors graduate, they go on, and our ensembles just keep getting smaller and smaller. It's a little difficult to keep going if it's like this," she added. I'm Mario Ritter, Jr.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
Joins me now to talk more about that education report. Hi, Mario.
Hi, Ashley.
Since the COVID-19 pandemic, many colleges have had fewer students seeking admission. With less income and higher costs, many schools are turning to budget cuts. That subject usually causes people to worry. On that note, I heard one term in the report that was especially interesting. Can you guess what that term might be?
Well, let's see. If I remember correctly, there was anxiety-ridden. Was that it?
That's right. Christina Westman, a student, said in the report, it was really anxiety-ridden when talking about budget cuts and job losses at the school she was attending. Now, ridden is the past participle of the verb ride. It's a short word from Old English. I think our listeners already know what to ride means. We ride bicycles, motorcycles, and horses. I would like to hear your theory about why ride is used to describe anxiety.
Wow, well, I guess I never thought about it. But let's see. Ride is an old English word that is used in a few special ways. When we ride a bike, moped, or horse, using the word means that we have control of it. We say we ride in a train or airplane because we are not controlling it. However, in a special use, hyphen ridden means controlled by.
So anxiety ridden, which is a hyphenated adjective, means controlled by anxiety. Is that right? So could we say happiness ridden then?
That's a really good question, Ashley. I don't think I've ever heard someone say happiness ridden or controlled by happiness. English speakers usually say fear ridden or anxiety ridden or trouble ridden. Ride describes a kind of control that is uncertain. You have to always pay attention while riding a bike or a horse, for example. So, if we are fear-ridden, there is a chance that we will not be that way in the future. It is not a permanent state.
That's an interesting theory, Mario. Well, thanks so much again for joining me.
Thanks, Ashley.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Is Anna Mateo.
My name is Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
You're listening to the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. Welcome to the part of the show where we help you do more with our series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C.
In lesson 22 of the series, Anna talks about her new show for children with her producer, Amelia. Together, they start to plan for the new show.
So, Anna, what's the plan for the show?
First, we're going to introduce the subject. Then, we can show pictures and video.
We can show tons of video.
Right. We can interview children and have guests, too.
Kids can ask us questions.
Oh, great idea. Finally, we can read the questions and tell them where to learn more.
Okay, let's try it.
Let's do it. Hi there, and welcome to... Amelia, we don't have a name for the show.
We'll think of a name later. For now, we'll call it the show.
Next, they start talking about fun things you can do in the summer. Anna and Amelia think they can include these in the children's show.
Hi there, and welcome to the show. Today, we are going to take you on a summer vacation. You will see popular things to do on vacation. One is camping. When you go camping, you cook, sleep, and play outdoors.
When I go camping, Anna, I like to go hiking and fishing.
Me too. Those are fun things to do when you go camping. These people are hiking.
Okay, let's talk about the next vacation.
Another popular summer vacation is going to an amusement park. at an amusement park. You go on rides and eat lots of fun food.
I love cotton candy.
And roller coasters!
This show is going to be a lot of fun.
I know. This is riding a roller coaster.
What is the last vacation?
One of the most popular summer vacations is going to the beach.
I love the beach!
When I see that blue ocean, I want to leave Washington, D.C. immediately and go to the beach.
That is a lot of fun activities. And it's fun to talk about. Well, having fun. So, Andrew, I'd like to ask you, what do you like to do for summer vacation?
I really like summer, and I like to do some of the same things Anna and Amelia talked about. I really like to go hiking in the mountains.
And we should explain that British English uses the word trekking to mean the same thing as hiking.
Hiking basically means walking in natural areas such as forests, mountains, and fields, or beside rivers and lakes.
It's kind of interesting that, on the one hand, we say go for a walk on the beach, and on the other hand, go for a hike in the mountains. We don't usually say hike on the beach.
That's true. I guess that's because walking on the beach is usually done in a relaxing manner. But hiking makes people think of longer or harder walks that take more energy.
There's more we could say about hiking, but let's go back to what you like to do for summer vacation.
Well, I also like to go to the beach, and I like to go swimming, and I like to play tennis. And when I have enough time and money, I like to visit friends in other parts of the U.S. or travel to other countries. How about you, Jill?
I love swimming at an outdoor pool. I also enjoy traveling to visit my family. Sometimes my brothers and sisters and I all get together in the summer. And I love going to beautiful places and painting them. I paint with acrylics, and I'm learning to use watercolors.
That sounds like an interesting thing to do in the summer. I think I would like to try that. We can use the verb like in three ways to talk about things we enjoy doing. First, we can say like to plus the base form of the action verb. For example, we can say, I like to read. Second, we can say like plus the ing form of the action verb.
For example, we can say I like reading. The ing form of the verb here is called the gerund.
And third, we can say like to plus the verb go plus the gerund.
We can hear this third form when Amelia and Anna talk about camping.
When I go camping, Anna, I like to go hiking and fishing.
Me too. Those are fun things to do when you go camping.
Here are some activities where you can use the verb go plus the gerund. Go camping, go swimming, go hiking, go fishing, go dancing, go shopping, go sightseeing, go biking, go running, go jogging, go skiing. Go ice skating, go roller skating, go sailing, and go surfing.
That was a big list, and I noticed that most of those activities involve some kind of movement or motion. And that makes sense, because the verb go makes us think of moving from place to place.
But for almost any activity, we can say like to plus the base form of the action verb. For example, we can say either I like to go swimming or I like to swim.
And the phrase I like to is something that's easy to say quickly, like this. I like to swim.
When we say it quickly, the word to is pronounced ta, I like to.
I like to swim. I like to bike. That's how it sounds faster. Ba-da-da-dum, ba-da-da-dum. That's the rhythm or beat of the phrase. Now listen to this chant where we use that beat. The phrases go by very quickly, but don't worry if you can't understand every word. Ready? Listen. There's so many things that I like to do. I like to run, I like to walk, I like to read, I like to talk, I like to teach, I like to learn, I like to dance, I like to sing, I like to sing and dance. There's so many things that I like to do. I like to cook, I like to eat, I like to cook, I like to eat, I like to eat, I like to eat, I like to eat, I like to eat.
You really like to eat.
Yes, I really like to eat. I like to watch TV, I like to read a magazine, I like to listen to the birds, I like to look at the moon. I like to walk in the hills, I like to swim in the sea, I like to lie in bed and rest my head. There's so many things that I like to do. I like to run, I like to walk, I like to read, I like to talk, I like to teach, I like to learn, I like to dance, I like to sing and dance. There's so many things that I like to do. I like to watch TV, I like to read a magazine, I like to listen to the birds, I like to look at the moon. I like to walk in the hills, I like to swim in the sea, I like to lie in bed and rest my head. There's so many things that I like to do. There's so many things that we all like to do. There's so many things that we all like to do. There's so many things that we all like to do. So write to us and tell us what you like too.
We know that was fast, but we want you to hear the rhythm of English and also just to have some fun with the language.
Having fun helps you learn. So you can play with the English language. For example, you can try to make up your own chants.
And in the Let's Learn English series, Amelia and Anna know that it is helpful to have fun. Let's listen to them one more time.
Okay, let's talk about the next vacation.
Another popular summer vacation is going to an amusement park. At an amusement park, you go on rides and eat lots of fun food.
I love cotton candy.
And roller coasters!
This show is going to be a lot of fun.
I know.
Jill, before we go, maybe we should mention the difference between the words fun and funny.
Something that is funny is something that makes you laugh, like a good joke or a special situation. Something that is fun is like an activity that feels enjoyable, like you are playing a game.
Jill, I have to say, doing this podcast with you is a lot of fun.
Thanks, Andrew. It's a blast.
It's a blast is a nice expression that means it's really fun. And we hope you've had fun listening to the lesson of the day. You can learn more on our website, learningenglish.voanews.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. And thank you for listening to the Learning English podcast. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.